kids, do you like podcasts? Do you like Disney podcasts? Oh boy, then you gotta meet my super swell friends in the world of commotion.
Join three Disney fans, Matt, Jared, and Danielle, as we explore inside and outside the Disney parks.
Follow the guide map with us in Rope Dropping as we make stops at every attraction and create the ultimate Disney ranking list. The unofficial Disney list for cool kids who like good stuff, registered trademark.
Currently, I've got security as number one. I think it's probably going to move.
Best experience we have so far.
And dive into the latest and not so latest things with us outside the parks and outside the bubble.
I do not wish to participate in your pool. Where is your observation area?
It's like two podcasts in one. So keep your hands, arms, and belongings inside the vehicle as you enjoy
the mildest ride in the wilderness.
New episodes of World of Commotion drop Wednesdays on the Zero Science Network.
Be cool, Daddy-O. Because hell is a musical, hell is a musical. Musical, musical hell. Stuck with Travolta and other people that you hate. But you have to do it anyway. Stuck in musical, musical, musical hell. With Lilz and Scott.
Hello and welcome to Hell is a Musical, where the road to hell is paved with choreographed and razzmatazz intentions. I'm Scott.
And I'm Lilz.
And Lilz, she is wearing a giant head.
I mean, you know, you didn't have to draw attention to it, but...
Okay, all right. It's your birthday, so we're doing Frank, which, in my opinion, is a musical the way A Mighty Wind is a musical.
I'm taking the head off. It's hot.
It's a musical the way A Mighty Wind is a musical, which means it's not a musical, but it's your birthday.
As in, it's a film that I can enjoy. For once.
Right. You get one a year. We do like 12 to 14 episodes a year. You get one.
I mean, I feel like you get one too.
Yeah, the entire... Every...
I mean, I didn't tell you that you had to pick musicals too.
But that's the premise of this podcast.
Yeah, I mean, but, you know, I didn't tell you had to. Just so everyone knows.
So what is Frank about?
Frank is a 2014 independent black comedy film directed by
Lenny Abrahamson,
later of the film Room.
Yeah, he made that right after this.
Yeah, interesting career trajectory. It stars Michael Fassbender, Domnhall Gleeson, Maggie Gyllenhaal, Scoot McNairy, and Francois Civil.
And Carla Azar.
She's the only other person
in this movie we probably should mention.
Of Autolux.
You know, if they could, they would have gotten Mitski. So, they're a cult, right? Like, let's just jump right into it. They're a cult the way the Polyphonic Spree is a cult, right?
I mean, I don't think it was explicitly said, but... There are so many implications of this, and I would be lying if I said I didn't, through my local music experiences, also meet my share of weirdly culty-seeming local bands that don't seem quite all there.
Like the Shags?
Yes, Scott, like the Shags. I was a local musician at the same time as the Shags in the 1960s.
You're a Time Lord, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Is it true that you can join the Polyphonic Spree if you just like buy one of their robes?
Oh, I mean, you don't even really have to do that. Like, I have my suspicions they don't even keep track. Like, if you just show up and just act like you know what you're doing, then they'll just assume you're part of it.
This is Jimmy and Jamie and Jimson and Jamison and Jamie and Jomley.
In fact, they'll just give you a robe. They'll see you and go, "Where's your robe? I forgot it. Oh, fine. Get a loner."
All right, reach for the sun.
You mentioned all names beginning with J. The Polyphonic Spree are not. God damn it! I'm spacing on the name of that weird Christian couple that had like 5 billion children all named.
Hi guys, Lilz here. I was thinking of the Duggar family. Bye.
George Foreman named all of his kids. George Foreman named all of his kids George. There's right. Georgina, Georgette, George, George Jr., George the Third, Georgia,
Jorts. Jorts Foreman.
Jorts Foreman. The Honorable Jorts Foreman.
All rise for the Honorable Judge Jorts Foreman. That's not the title of this episode. I'm declaring that now.
That's not or is?
It's not.
Okay.
That'd be too easy.
There's still time. There's still time. So Frank is actually based on the comedy persona of Chris Seavey.
I'm not sure how it's pronounced, but yeah, it's based
something
on
British.
On the comic persona of Christopher Mark Seavey, one of those.
Something British.
An English musician and comedian, first known for fronting an English punk group called the Freshies, but in the late 1970s onward, he became known for the comic persona Frank Sidebottom.
Yeah, who this Frank is based on.
Yeah. And if you've ever, like, gone back and look for Frank Sidebottom clips or whatever on YouTube, the likeness is shameless.
Yeah, it's pretty much the same.
I mean, I would say, though, I think the one they used in the movie is kind of a higher quality mask than the Chris Seavey Frank Sidebottom mask.
Yeah, because they had a budget. They had a budget of, you know, like $20 to make a top-notch papier-mâché.
Right.
Or should I say papier-mâché?
Papier-mâché. Later, so, fiberglass.
Yeah, it was fiberglass and papier-mâché, and apparently there was a little speaker in it.
Yeah. Or, I mean, was it a speaker? Like, I just sort of assumed it was like a vent for air.
Oh, okay.
Though in the movie, they have, like, that cord sticking out, which implies they've got, like, you know, some kind of microphone jack in there.
Yeah.
That they can just connect to, which I think is really cool.
So, I always thought that there should be like a 1960s style band called Michael and the Fassbenders. Like how they had, you know, Jerry and the Pacemakers.
So, hang on. When you say a 60s style band, is this a contemporary band covering things in the 1960s style?
It's Michael Fassbender. In his costume from X-Men First Class, where he has the blazer and the black turtleneck, wearing sunglasses, Roy Orbison style, with a band of, you know, all the other actors who kind of look like him.
So it's Magneto's local band.
I like Michael and the Fassbenders better. Because you got, like, Jerry and the Pacemakers and the Dave Clark Five and, you know.
Right. But Michael, that's what you meant by 60s band, not a band from the 1960s should have existed called Michael and the Fassbenders.
No,
German Irish actor would eventually take as his namesake.
Right, that's exactly what I'm saying. That it should be a modern band with a 60s mentality, kind of like how Haim is like three Stevie Nicks.
Makes total sense. Like one of those swing revival kind of bands, except, you know, later.
Well, if you think about it now, like, as I said before, Haim is like three Stevie Nickses, and then you have, like...
I believe the plural term is Stevie's Nicks.
A cauldron of Stevies.
A cauldron.
It should be a coven, but, you know, it's like the three men in the tub.
Nope, we're going with cauldron.
A cauldron of Stevies.
A cauldron of Stevie's Nicks. Maybe that's the title.
Yeah, probably. I mean, nothing is going to be confirmed Bachelor Ding Tinkler. At this point, it's all downhill from here. For however many years we do this podcast, it's going to be all downhill from there. Ding Tinkler was our Everest.
It's like our podcast is like driving a car off of the lot. It gradually loses... It just gradually loses value over time.
I would say it's more like a kangaroo driving a car. It's all over the place, but it gets you where you need to go.
Sure.
Just saying. So, Domnhall Gleeson's character, John, is our main character but he is also the villain of this film.
Yeah, whether he realizes it or not.
We are following the bad guy of the movie.
Yeah, pretty much. And it doesn't really become clear that, like, oh, this is the antagonist until maybe, like, the midway point of the film.
I would say...
The midway point villain, Domnhall Gleeson, who is basically playing Ed Sheeran.
So he's playing Rupert Grint.
No, I said Ed Sheeran.
Well, I was trying to do a callback because Ed Sheeran had Rupert Grint play him in a music video, and then Domnhall Gleeson played Rupert Grint's brother in Harry Potter.
I did not know that.
I'm just saying that it's a circle of Sharons.
How many of these are we going to come up with throughout this episode?
I'll do my damnedest.
But yeah, he's basically he's an aspiring like local level musician.
Oh, don't say aspiring. He sucks.
No, I say aspiring in the sense that like he really really wants it but can't get over the fact that he's, you know,
sucks.
Boring. So, and sucks.
Lady
yeah.
in the red shirt.
Yeah, he. Yeah. I mean, to be fair, that one did sort of sound a bit like an Oasis song, but you get what I mean. Like he's just like he's the personification of the earnest guy at a party with an acoustic guitar who thinks they're so much deeper than they actually are.
Well, anyway, here's Wonderwall,
and he happens upon an absolutely crazy Animal Collective space rock type band by accident.
How'd you say their name?
It's never made clear. I pretty much go by, like, they made an appearance and performed on the Colbert Report.
I was thinking about that. And
Stephen Colbert introduced them as the Soronprfbs, so I just go with that.
And he said it with such vigor and confidence.
Yes. And the fact that he said it with such confidence that no one else had really just...
The Soronprfbs.
The Soronprfbs. You got to really lean into the B word fat at the end there. Soronprfbs.
I was trying to find that clip today from Colbert, and I can't find it anywhere because
that's a bummer because I remember, like, I think I was in college at the time when that happened.
It was 2014.
Maybe I was in college, but either way, I remember seeing that clip in some context and being just so jazzed and wondering why they didn't just take that as like, you know, and just play, you know, local level clubs on a tour or something like that, because they were really, really good.
Yeah, and all the actors in the movie play their instruments.
Yeah, they all learned how to play their own instruments. Maggie Gyllenhaal learned how to be a friggin' synth witch.
And a theremin.
Yeah.
Theremonium? Theremonious?
What? No, you had it right the first time.
It doesn't matter. Her brother pissed off Taylor Swift. I love how they're all like different types of musicians from different, you know, genres. Like clearly, Maggie Gyllenhaal's Clara is basically like Nico from the Velvet Underground.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of Velvet Underground-y kind of, you know, parallels going on with the Soronprfbs, right? Right on down to the fact that Carla Azar's character, Nana, the drummer, plays with timpani mallets.
Yeah.
Which was definitely something that Maureen Tucker did.
Yeah. Another cult.
Yep.
Just remember, everyone, musicians are cults. That's why you should stick with musical theater.
But,
I mean,
yeah.
What's cult like about, you know, a bunch of actors getting together and, you know, yelling into each other's mouths? That is an acting exercise that I've done before.
Oh, no. I'm not a fan of that. But yeah, Domhnall Gleeson, his character John, basically happens upon a man trying to kill himself by drowning himself in the ocean, who just happens to be the keyboardist for the Soronprfbs. And so he just, on a whim, just gets invited to play with them at the gig that the suicidal keyboardist was supposed to do tonight. The keyboardist, by the way, which ends up looking a lot like John ends up looking later in the film, which I didn't really make that connection until this latest viewing.
Also, like, Scoot McNairy kind of looks that way, too.
Yeah, a little bit. He's not ginger like the other two guys, though.
Right. I told you about being called Scoot, right?
You did. I think you brought it up at the charity stream too.
Oh, okay. If I haven't told it on mic, should I just tell it again?
I mean, why not?
I used to work at a Gap, and there was this woman who she was from the Ukraine, and she would always come into the Gap and buy like a ton of clothes. So when she came in, we like shut down the store. But she always called me like she read my name tag really fast, so she just goes, "Oh, Scoot, Scoot, help me, Scoot." And then when she couldn't remember my name, she just called me, "Oh, boy, Cabana boy." like I was a Cabana boy.
Well, if it isn't a boy.
The Cabana boy of the Gap. That's right.
The Gap boy.
Scoot, the Cabana boy of the Gap.
But anyway, John fills in at the gig, and it's about as well as you'd expect a local dive bar gig to go if you know anything about local band type stuff. The whole thing is kind of a mess, but they play some awesome space rock until Clara has a freak out over like some electrical difficulties and gets super, super violent.
Is it Francois Seville who she...
She freaks out on Francois Seville's character, the guitarist Barak.
Who, and can we talk about how that guy looks like he is the love child of Benicio del Toro and Edgar Wright?
Yeah, a little bit. He definitely looks like he has definitely looks like he has Captain Morgan for breakfast.
He is a baby driver. He is Adam Driver.
At that gig, John meets the titular Frank, who is a very, very eccentric fellow wearing a papier-mache head, much like the aforementioned Frank Sidebottom. Yeah.
Apparently, Fassbender read the screenplay right before he went to make 12 Years a Slave, and he's like, hold on to this. I'm on board. I will do whatever it takes to get this movie made. And then he did it. He got the movie made.
Yeah, based on stories, it really sounded like Michael Fassbender was really, really excited to just do this film.
Because this script had been around since 1999, early 2000s.
Dang.
It had been cycling. As soon as Chris Seavey, Frank Sidebottom, came onto the scene, they're like, we need to make a movie about this. And they, like, in 2003, 2004, they tried courting Johnny Depp. Because
I'm glad they didn't go with Johnny Depp.
Johnny Depp would have sucked.
He would have made the whole thing just stupid.
Yeah. He would have talked like a pirate the whole time. And I need to mention the fact that I love every time Fassbender just starts speaking German in a movie.
Yeah, that does just sort of come out of nowhere. Really does just sort of cement this whole idea that he's some sort of amazing, angelical wunderkind being there figure.
Yeah. He is the leader of this cult. This cult where they have sex in hot tubs. Which that is how you get a UTI or a yeast infection.
Oh yes, don't do that. Don't, especially not just in the middle of the woods of Ireland.
Especially not with Domnhall Gleeson, who I'm sure he's a lovely man. I love him. I would love to see him play Harry Nilsson in a movie. But
yeah, we like Domnhall Gleeson, but at that point in the movie when that happened, his beard looked like it had an ecosystem.
Right. I think he was preparing for The Revenant at that point. Like,
was he in The Revenant too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Touching
very briefly back on like how excited Michael Fassbender seemed about this film. Now that I know that, like, you know, you tell me that like he was on board as far back as like 12 Years a Slave. It makes me wonder if like he just went through that whole movie, like, you know, that grim reminder of our, you know, terrible, depraved history, just going like, I can't wait to wear the papier-mache mask.
Oh, it was way before 12 Years a Slave, now that I'm looking at it, because he got script in 2011. So that's X-Men First Class. So
yeah, this Magneto hat's pretty good, but it's no papier-mâché mask. I really want to wear that papier-mâché mask.
Do you think that he liked wearing the Magneto helmet so much? He's like, I need to wear stuff on my face.
I can't help but notice you completely just, you know, soared by the fact that I called it a Magneto hat.
It is a Magneto hat. But that's what it is. It's a hat for Magneto's.
Yes, it is. It's Magneto's magic hat.
Yeah, like Mr. Magorium's Wonder Emporium, you have Magneto's magic hat. But if you look at Fassbender's career, he's made like a career out of having like either things on his head or like hair that sticks out. Because
yeah, I suppose so.
Because
like, what else has he been in?
Well, there's of course Assassin's Creed, where he has a hood on for like 75% of the movie.
He was like a lieutenant in Inglourious Bastards, so he almost certainly had like the sticky note on his head during that one scene.
Yes. Fitz Pelulik. There was also in Prometheus, he dyed his hair platinum blonde.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Fassbender loves crap on his head.
I wonder if that gets annoying to his co-stars at all.
Michael, please take off that little rascal's beanie. No. Woo! And he just spins the propeller on top.
Oh, Lord help them if they ever find themselves driving past a Spirit Halloween. Michael Fassbender just like,
we have to stop.
Like, we gotta pull over. Oh, no, Michael, come on.
I said we gotta pull over.
I'm a Roman Centurion. And now I'm Elvis. Now I'm Elvis in Roman Centurion hat.
Now I'm Borat. Big Boner.
My wife.
Big Boner.
Big Boner. Just give him this.
We should have never introduced him to that Hell is a Musical podcast. Now I'm Eugene Hoots.
Just give it like maybe two more hours. They'll get tired by then, and then we can finally put Michael Fassbender down for a nap.
I found a clip of him promoting X-Men First Class, and he was on, I think it was the British version, the UK version of the Late Late Show. I think that's Jonathan Ross's one, but he's singing Twist and Shout
as Magneto, I hope.
No, he did not have the Magneto hat on.
that's disappointing.
It's such a shame that he's made so many bad movies in the last couple of years. Because if you look at this trajectory that he was on, like in 2009, he did Inglourious Bastards, and then he did Hunger, Shame.
He made his feature film debut in 300. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Once again, another thing on his head.
Well, he also... that's his feature film debut, but one of his first roles is he was in Band of Brothers, so he...
Where he wore a thing on his head.
His head. Oh, he loves his hats. But now that he's been making, like, weird choices for movies, ever since he did, like, the Ridley Scott movies... Not just Prometheus, not just Alien Covenant. He also did The Counselor. Like, his films have tanked.
Not good.
And so now he's doing Kung Fury.
Oh, boy.
The live action, the feature length version of Kung Fury.
Oh, boy, oh, boy. So anyway, after that, after the disastrous gig, John all of a sudden finds himself invited to become a full-time member of the band. He agrees and is whisked away to Ireland to spend a year in a remote cabin while they work on recording their debut album.
Yeah, the way he like mentions that he plays the keyboard when this guy is trying to kill himself, he's like, I play the keyboard.
Yeah, that was that. I mean, when you put it that way, it just sounds kind of like, yeah, I play keyboard. Fuck that guy. He's about to die.
Yeah, I played.
We got to move on. Move on, man. Move on to the future.
You're living in the past.
You're living in the past, man. We got to look ahead to the Domnhall Gleeson future.
Yeah, I'm just going to destroy the band. Also, I'm not.
Where I have a beard that's also a biome.
He looks like, with the beard on, he looks like a redheaded version of Robin Williams from Jumanji?
Yeah, a little bit.
Did one of you roll a 5 or an 8? He did.
Ah! But yeah, when we reach that point in the film and John is just so, you know, just so confused about like, oh, I've told work that I'd be back on Monday.
Why the fuck would you do that?
Yeah, I was just saying to myself, no, don't you want to be whisked away to Ireland and just like hang out in a cabin for a while? I mean, back then we weren't all like, you know, late stage capitalism hadn't ruined everything quite so much back in 2014 yet. But yeah, I mean, that looked like a lot of fun. Spend a lot of time in Ireland just recording shit. I mean, you know, until the rent ran out.
Yeah. And then he had to deplete his nest egg. That's how they make you feel bad for him, is that he was like doing all this money and then he does something shitty.
Like that's another part of it. He's basically just cataloging his entire experience through various tweets and recording them on YouTube without their consent, because that's cool.
And this was like YouTube at the beginning, when this was the age of YouTube where in 2014 is when they really started, people who were getting like a couple hundred thousand views or, you know, they were getting money. So if they just kept a YouTube channel and made this like a documentary, like a mockumentary channel, they would have been like so rich.
Yeah, they might not have even needed to play at South by Southwest.
Can we talk about the hipster girls at South by Southwest?
Oh boy.
I could talk the rest of this episode about those hipster girls because they are the biggest cliche.
They kind of are. They look
my
like
name
they
is
were
Sapphire,
just...
and I have a funny hat on the back of my head. Michael Fassbender keeps trying to wear it, but I'm like, not today.
They look like they were pulled directly out of Lena Dunham's throat.
Yeah. We're the girls from Girls. No, you're not.
You're right, we're not, but we're a very similar facsimile, don't you think?
Yeah, I just remember watching the movie Under the Silver Lake with Andrew Garfield, who we'll be talking about very soon. But all of the girls in Under the Silver Lake are this type of hipster girl who they're like, oh, we like good music and, you know, we like to have sex.
Manic pixie, knit hat hipsters.
Yeah.
Of the kind that you invariably see at a coffee house.
Yeah, I also love how like awkward they get when Frank gets awkward.
Oh, man. Like, that's jumping pretty far ahead, but when they were in, like, the restaurant, and that one girl playing the ukulele is just, no thank you. This is coming from someone who has known and been friends with many a ukulele-playing granola girl, and been too polite
you know
to say,
Kate
like,
Micucci?
And been too polite to say, like, maybe don't do that.
Have you ever read Ready Player One? Not seen the movie. There is literally a chapter that he dedicates of how he likes finding old YouTube videos of girls who play ukuleles. He finds it relaxing.
He finds it relaxing. Okay. Sure. I don't understand this person. This protagonist of Ready Player One.
Where it's set like, you know, 75 years way in the future when YouTube isn't a thing anymore. But hey, let's not go there. Why are you thinking about it? You shouldn't be thinking about it.
Yeah, maybe don't include that on your historical deep dive. It's just like, oh, I'm going to learn all about the music of the past. The Beatles, the classical era, swing dancing, granola girl with a ukulele playing a kooky hipster version of Hey Ya.
Nothing's better than, you know, a ukulele girl playing the Decemberists. Yeah, so when they're, like, recording and this German family comes in, it's kind of upsetting because you realize how like controlled by Frank. Like, I don't think Frank realizes he's controlling people, but poor Scoot McNairy, you know, underrated character actor Scoot McNairy.
Right, he's portraying their manager, who will later learn used to be the keyboardist of the group.
And then all of a sudden, as soon as he unfortunately kills himself, Domnhall Gleeson doesn't Do you know how long I was pronouncing his name Domnhall? Apparently in Ireland, you don't say the N's. The M's. You say the N's, but you don't say the M's. So it's Donnell.
Donnell.
Donnell. But yeah, he's like, I'm now the manager. Ha-cha-cha-cha-cha.
It's what Don would want.
No, it isn't.
Because I intimately know what that would be. He in confidence sang a song to me about wanting to have sex with mannequins. I'm not making that up.
Yeah,
that's in the film.
I just picture Frank being like, that's what that song was about.
Oh my god. I was gonna have that played at my wedding.
Your wedding to Maggie Gyllenhaal?
Yes. The very loud and scrunky wedding.
So, Maggie Gyllenhaal was not supposed to be in this movie.
No?
No. I'm looking it up now. I think this would have been way too early for Elizabeth Olsen. But someone of, like, that caliber of an actress, like, kind of indie. I think maybe it was Margot
Critically
Robbie.
Critically acclaimed.
Yeah, it might have been Elizabeth Olsen. This could have been around the time where Elizabeth Olsen was getting traction. But the actor... Oh, it was Scarlett Johansson.
I'm glad they went with Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Because Scarlett Johansson would have been a little too on the nose.
Yeah, much in the same way as if they had gone with Johnny Depp instead of Michael Fassbender.
It would have been hysterical if Katie Holmes was originally supposed to be the role and they replaced her with Maggie Gyllenhaal, just like they did in Batman.
Hey, that's the synergy-ish.
Well,
I don't know.
At this point, so Maggie Gyllenhaal's career is so weird. Like, Jake Gyllenhaal, like, he, ever since 1998, when he did October Sky, he had been on, like, just... skyrocketing. He'll like disappear every now and then, but he'll always come back with like huge hit after huge hit. Where Maggie Gyllenhaal,
yeah, he's a bankable like presence.
Maggie Gyllenhaal will try to do like a big budget movie and it will tank, and then she'll do an indie film and get nominated for an Oscar, and they're like, oh yeah, Maggie Gyllenhaal, the other one.
Yeah,
too mean.
I'm just
too mean.
Well, I mean, I'm just looking at like her filmography right here, and like I'm seeing like the adaptation, Confessions of a Dangerous Mind, Crazy Heart, Frank, and then there's the White House Down, Nanny McPhee and the Big Bang.
Nanny McPhee and the Big Bang Theory? That's where Nanny McPhee goes to take care of Sheldon?
Yeah, she takes care of Sheldon.
She kills Sheldon. Yeah.
That's the happy ending. Anyway.
So, Scoot McNairy is like so obsessed with Frank, where it just seems like everyone is like in love with Frank. But when you realize that he's in love with mannequins, I think Scoot McNairy is only in love with Frank because he looks like a mannequin.
But yeah, right. The band is pretty like just sort of beholden to Frank just in general.
Yeah.
And, you know, Domnhall Gleeson's John clearly wants to be a part of that, but...
He has
like,
no
even,
talent.
Like, yeah, even with a big beard, he still just sounds like Ed Sheeran.
He is just on the A-team. Yep.
Ed Sheeran is boring. That's the joke.
How can Ed Sheeran be boring? Elton John bought him a suit. Did you hear
That's
that story?
Nice. No, I did not hear that story.
Elton John wrote him a letter and was like, you dress like shit. Here, I bought you this pink suit.
But he's doing a thing with Cradle of Filth, I heard. Try hard.
Wait, Ed Sheeran did...
That's also something that apparently... I don't know if it ever actually happened, but like I saw some story on, I want to say Stereo Gum or something, like Ed Sheeran in talks to collaborate with Cradle of Filth.
For Cradle of Sharon. Cradle of Ed.
That's the plural, a cradle of Eds.
Yes.
And it just, I never really like looked into that story beyond like just looking at that with all the energy of just like, well, that's certainly a thing that happened.
You would love the movie Red Notice, because in the movie, Ed Sheeran is playing at a wedding that these rich people hired him to play at, and then they get arrested by the FBI, and he gets arrested and, like, manhandled.
For being Ed Sheeran, I assume.
Well, like, they come, they arrest the bride, and then he takes his guitar and starts swinging it at them, so they, like, break the guitar. And all the alternative music fans were like, yay!
I'm sure the subtext invariably was, like, he got arrested because he's Ed Sheeran.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what I choose to believe. Like, anyway, all that has happened. They're playing crazy space rock in the woods. Don, the manager, kills himself, and they hold a Viking funeral. And
okay,
it's around...
yeah, let's talk about that.
Oh, yeah?
Cause...
I mean, it was certainly... It sure was lucky that the raft just happened to come back.
But that's my point.
With everything intact.
I would just love... oh, my God, what's his name? Francois Seville's character.
Barack.
I almost said Baroque. Barack to be like, should we call the police? No. Too many questions. That's why this is like a cult, because someone
got... Yeah. I mean, who's to say that Don didn't have any extended family or loved ones that needed to know that, like, you know, he had passed?
And there's no way that the fire was that hot to turn him into ashes. Like,
yeah.
Some bone would come back.
Yeah, certainly not overnight.
Yeah, this is not like they put him out on the water in a kiln. They're like, let's light that kiln on fire.
They put him out in one of those cooking shows where, like magic, as soon as it goes in, we open it up, oh, there's a cake! Through TV magic. Through TV magic, we open it up, and there's a pile of bone powder.
Oh, man, there's bone powder and Flavor Town. That's my favorite, you know, 90s band, Bone Powder and Flavor Town.
Hmm.
Would that be early 2000s? Like, you got Crazy Town?
Bone Powder and Flavor Town?
Yep.
I mean, it has, like, the kind of an edgelordy name, but also a very long name, so could go either way.
It's just a guy with, you know, a barbed wire tattoo.
Very on the same level as, like, a fun-loving criminals kind of thing.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's... Oh, sorry.
Oh, I was going to say, call the police. Because technically, you just make it look like you covered up a murder.
Yeah. How else are, like, just a... How else would a random observer take that? Like... Imagine if, like, at that moment, that was the exact time that, like, the German couple that Frank enriched the lives of just suddenly showed back up. Just pulled up like, sorry, you forgot to...
Gets in the car. I love how when she leaves, she's, like, awakened. And the husband has, like, such a smile on his face. He's like, ooh, I'm having kudelbop it tonight. That's what we call sex.
I was here too.
I'm so excited. I'm Lars and I'm getting kudelbop.
Hello, my name is Lars and I'm getting kudelbop.
It means sex. Yeah, we know. We figured that out. I love how
physical sex. Yes, we
yeah,
understand.
We know.
Like penis to vagina.
Yeah,
Lars.
We get it. Jesus,
God
Christ
damn it. Why do we keep inviting him to our parties? I'm a people person.
No, you're not. You eat people.
And I'm a person.
Oh, God damn it. But this is when Domnhall Gleeson is like, oh, yeah, Don's dead. So, South by Southwest?
Yeah, this is around the time that it comes out that... that John has been just sort of recording the band without
David
consent.
Attenborough style.
Yeah. And just making them, like, you know, getting them lots of views on YouTube, which really no one's into except for Frank. And I would say that's the correct reaction to not be into it.
Yeah.
But then again, Frank clearly isn't quite right in the head.
But what would this David Attenborough documentary be called? Planet Space Rock? We see the Frank goes to the microphone, looks around, and stream of consciously says whatever he wants while the synth plays elegantly in the background.
And the lady with the theremin shouts a lot at people.
What the fuck did you say about me? Uh-oh. She can hear me.
Get the car.
I just want to see this documentary of, like... So, back in college, I was making a short film that was, like, a nature documentary, but it was about film nerds. One film nerd will show his movie collection to another film nerd to establish his dominance. If it's good enough... he will be accepted into their society. If not, he'll be cast out like a leper. That's what I want to see, but with Frank. We skipped past the fact that Frank's regimen of like exercise and you know, playing with weird instruments includes him chasing Domnhall Gleeson with an axe, saying, "This will be good for you." Which that line apparently was improvised. It was just supposed to be him running with an axe, and Domnhall Gleeson was, like, on the set that day, so he saw him and just started chasing him, and they kept filming.
That is incredibly good.
They're basically like an improv group.
Or like a corporate retreat.
All right, time for the trust fall. Ay, ay, ay. So they get to South by Southwest, but first, they spread the ashes of... Dawn, and it turns out that it's not Dawn, it's just the Nesquik powder stuff that they were drinking.
Gronut.
What is that?
It's like a Soylent nutritional sort of drink kind of thing, as I understand it.
Oh, that's what Frank eats,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And I'll be honest, the first time that I saw this movie, it took me a while to realize they weren't saying Cronut.
wanted a Cronut?
So that's funny. I guess.
Wait, did you think that they make cronuts out of powder?
No, I don't know. I don't know what I thought. I just thought they were saying cronuts.
You're like, hey, shut up.
Why are they drinking it? You don't drink the cronut. You put it in your mouth and eat the cronut.
So basically, when they finally get to South,
it made sense.
When they finally get to South by Southwest, this is where Clara has had enough. And sees that Frank's mental health is deteriorating.
Yeah, that's where Frank's anxiety starts to really just sort of, you know, hit a level.
Yeah.
That apparently wasn't there before.
Yeah. Because we find out that he has a mental illness.
Yep.
And then everyone leaves them.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, Clara is basically forced out after she tries to kill John.
Yep.
Via stabbing.
Yeah, you can't do that in the real world. You can't stab people.
Yeah, that's generally frowned upon.
So then at South by Southwest, he starts playing his shitty song.
Well, I mean, leading up to that, he basically puts in Frank's head that, like as soon as Frank starts to really just sort of deteriorate after learning how many people are going to be there that aren't already fans of them. Like, he puts in Frank's head that they need to be more relatable and more pop-friendly, and which leads to an incredibly entertaining scene of Frank's interpretation of pop-friendly, immediately followed by more Ed Sheeran.
Yeah. I just love the Coca-Cola lipstick Ringo.
Oh, yeah. That's easily one of the best songs on the... I mean, personally, I'm a fan of... Personally, I like all of the songs on this soundtrack, and there's 31 songs on this soundtrack.
Are there?
Yeah. Like, there wasn't a listing on Wikipedia, so I had to look it up on the lightintheattic.net reissue on vinyl, and there's 31 songs.
Oh, boy.
Some of them seem to be just, like, duplicates of, like, this is the credits version sort of thing, but still.
I'm glad I'm not the poor bastard who has to edit this one.
Yeah.
Shit. Yeah. Careful what you wish for your birthday. It's like gift of the fucking magi. But I sold all my hair for you to get this pocket watch.
I didn't want a pocket watch.
Well, I have no hair now.
I wanted your hair.
What if that was what Gift of the Match I was? You have beautiful long hair, and I'm bald. I wanted your hair. That's all I wanted.
I want to buy your hair. Where are you going? Come back. I'm not weird. I swear.
South by Southwest doesn't go well, and the look on the girls' faces when, like, they tank, the hipster girls, like, they're like, oh, they suck.
I mean, to be fair, the Soronprfbs don't suck. John sucks.
Yeah, John sucks really bad.
And once he, like, just sort of asserts himself as the dominant force in it, with like, Frank basically doing less and less and, like, having less creative control over time, because, like, Frank up to this point has been just very friendly, cheerful, like, oh, this is great. But he, like, has a huge breakdown once he realizes how much John sucks.
Yeah, your music's terrible. Basically, this causes a fight. Frank runs out into the middle of the road, gets hit by a car, and then John realizes, oh, I'm a piece of shit.
And then he gets hit by a car.
Yep. And he tracks down the real Frank, who, when we meet him, he finally doesn't have his mask on. And you find out, oh no, he has all these scars on his face. Is this from, like, why he wore the mask? No, apparently he had a beautiful face. The scars are from getting hit by the car, thanks to John.
Yeah, great work, John.
Yeah, I think the thing that made me kind of, you know, feel even worse for Frank is when he finally shows up at Frank's house. I just imagine in Frank's head, he's like, oh God, he found me. And then his father, Frank's dad, gives a great speech about how, you know, he didn't have a tortured family. He did not have a tortured relationship. You know,
yeah, that's like been kind of a recurring motif through the whole thing, is that there's like this air of mystery around Frank that, like, you know, since he was in a mental hospital at one point, he must have had, like, just have suffered some sort of, like, trials and tribulation and abuse throughout his life that really just sparked his creativity. And then they learn, no, he's just always been creative. He just has a mental disorder.
Yeah.
Which really just drives home how absolutely shitty it was that John would try to, like, you know, contain and exploit that. Or try to, like, redirect it into himself.
So, thank God, John reunites him with, you know, the rest of the band, and then he fucks off.
Yep. He fucks off back to England, where I'm sure he's gonna have to explain a lot to his parents he lives with.
So, wanna get into the tracks?
Yep. Alright. First track, like... Oh, actually, looking at this, I'm seeing, like, the first four tracks have all actually been combined in every other version I've seen. The first four tracks are all ones from John just really trying hard to write a song.
Yeah.
They're called Endless Rolling Waves, Children Building Castles in the Sand, Bands Playing in My Town, Lady in the Red Coat, and Lady in the Red Coat. On the soundtrack, it's called John's Shit Songs.
Yeah.
Ladies have babies. That's how it works. Lady in the red coat, what you doing with that bag? Lady in the blue coat, do you know the lady in the red coat?
I mean, it's exactly what it says on the tin.
They're shitty songs.
They're shitty songs that are just way too full of themselves. Not much else to it. If you've ever been to any local shows whatsoever, then, you know, you've seen this. Oh, there's also Little Boxes.
Yeah.
Which is also part of it.
Yep.
After that, we've got the first Soronprfbs song, The Ginger Crouton.
I love The Ginger Crouton. I think it's a really good song.
Me too. I mean, I think all the Soronprfbs songs are really good until they get perverted by, you know, John's input.
Yeah.
But Ginger Crouton in particular is friggin' great. And, like, I do not know, between this and the other ones, why John would think, like, people wouldn't like this kind of music at a big hipster place where people almost certainly already like crazy Animal Collective space rock kind of music already.
Well, same thing with South by Southwest. Like, he is a Paul McCartney surrounded by George Harrison's and John Lennon's. Too mean.
No, I would. I don't think that's too out of there.
He's like a Paul McCartney who tried to join Dave Grohl's other bands, and Dave's like, oh.
He's like the lone Mike Love in a band full of Brian Wilsons.
Yes.
Or rather, a Brian Wilson and several Dennis Wilsons. After that,
he's a lone Dr. Gene Lundy. Too dark?
Yeah, I think that might have done it. After that, we got another Soronprfbs song, Aviary.
Yes. Like an aviary. You're birds. You're plumber. Banana. Moorhen. Clara. Gal. Night hunter. Silent killer.
Is this when they first get to the compound?
Yeah, I think that's like their little warm-up jam sort of stuff where, like, Frank is yelling at them, like, you're birds, you're the owl, you're the gingerbread, and he basically just screams at John until he lays an egg.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Laying egg. Laying egg with me. You tell me. What?
But yeah, this is just another sort of, just another very kind of like Pink Floyd-y kind of psychedelic track, which, as I understood, people liked.
Once again, the character of John is an Ed Sheeran amongst, you know, a bunch of Vampire Weekends.
Yeah, pretty much. After that, we got Lone Standing Tuft, which probably is one of my favorites.
It's such a beautiful song, and it's so, like...
It is, and it's all just came out of, like, Frank just seeing, like, a little piece of, like, fabric just sticking out of the couch.
Lone standing tough, defy the foot. Is it work that you're still standing and you've not been flattened too?
That's the point in the movie where, you know, the show's like, oh, that's part of Frank's mysterious genius, that he can just pull a song like that out of thin air. And it's great.
I find it funny because the next track we're getting into, all the John songs were written by Domnhall Gleeson, and I think he knew that they were supposed to be shitty. Mm.
Were they all written by Domnhall Gleeson? Because I'm looking at it. A couple of the earlier ones had lyrics by Lenny Abrahamson.
The ones that I'm looking at, yeah, it's a combination. But you know, these next few ones,
I have to imagine though they both were working in tandem towards the same, you know, end game of like making a song that sounds
like shit.
So that sounds deliberately mediocre. Which brings us to Walking Down the Street. That's a John song, and it's crap.
Yep.
I was walking down the street one day, thinking about the lady I love, when a guy comes down and says, what do you do? Lady in the red coat, what you doing with that bag? Fuck, you know when you've just got so many songs and then just none of them will fucking come out?
Not much to say about that.
Next track.
Next track is one that sounds pretty until you realize it's Don singing it. Be Still.
Be still and let me in. Let me in. But be still. Oh, baby.
Yeah.
That's the mannequin fucking song.
Yep.
And like, unless you're really tuned into, like, I have a problem where like I'm not good at like picking out lyrics and songs unless they're like directly up front. So I didn't realize until partway through, like, oh, he's literally singing about fucking a mannequin.
Yes.
So that's fun.
It's upsetting when you realize it.
After that, Breathe.
Oh, by Michelle Branch?
No, not that. That's incorrect.
Now you have to insert a clip of Breathe by Michelle Branch.
Yeah, I'll get right on that. Here it is. This is a clip of Breathe by Michelle Branch. Breathe. That's where it goes. But no, Breathe by the Soronprfbs.
I forgot this one.
I'll be honest, I forgot this one too, and I just watched the movie.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of hard to keep track, like, the titles of some of these songs, just because so many of them sound like just total space rock freakouts.
Oh, I think this one is the Into the Galactic, whatchamacallit?
Nuclear bombs. Is that by all the supernova? Ouch!
That was the one. Like, was that the one that they performed, like, when they absolutely, you know, just started recording proper?
Yeah, I think that's what Breathe is.
Mm. After
Into
that, we
the
got
Galactic.
After that, we got the La 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 song, which
sucks.
Just going by the title, I'm assuming it's another John song, and therefore
it is.
Sucks.
La 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 la. It goes up. La la.
Do you remember which one that was?
It's when they asked to hear his when he performs for them and they fix it.
You mind?
Please.
Okay, so.
Oh, yeah, that was the one where they just basically completely overtake his composition, which I would say rightfully so.
Yeah, it took three of them to write it. It took Domnhall Gleeson, Stephen Renix, and Dara O'Kelly.
Hmm. Then they did a very good job then, making it suck. Anyway, we got I'm Just Me. I'm assuming that's the ukulele song.
That's the ukulele girl.
Performed by Jordan Aurora Aquino. You know, I'm sure she's perfectly. I'm sure she's fine.
I just picture
that
someone
is
being
a
like,
"Bad song."
I just picture someone being like, "I'm trying to eat my pancakes here."
After that, we got "Broken," performed by the Soronprfbs. This is another one I honestly don't remember either.
This is like when they're practicing before. When I think it's like before Maggie Gyllenhaal goes crazy on them. It's when he like starts to break down.
Ah, okay. Following that, I'm sure what is surely the star of this soundtrack, Frank's most likable song.
Dance all night. I've got dancing legs. Woo! I've got dancing legs. They won't stop me dancing. No, they won't stop me dancing. Kiss me, just kiss me. Kiss me, Nefertiti. Just the way you like it.
I got dancing legs. Woo!
Woo!
Honestly, how this song wasn't nominated, this or I Love You All was not nominated for an Oscar. Beats me.
Yeah. I mean, come on.
It's great.
It's so good. It's like there's a reason why that one's the one was that was like in all the marketing and all that sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And just like the reaction to it at the very end was just like,
this is your most likable song ever.
Yeah.
People will love it.
And we did. We fucking love it. Following that, we got Lighthouse Keeper, another Soronprfbs song minus Frank.
I want to marry a lighthouse keeper and keep him company. I want to marry a lighthouse keeper.
This was the one that they were performing.
This is the
right
Nico
they...
one. This is where she's flat out Nico.
Yeah. Where they're just bringing Frank back to meet up with the band, like have the reunion right before John fucks off. Rightly so, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Lighthouse Keeper isn't an original song, right? That's from like something else, I think.
Yeah, it's a different performer.
Mm.
I mean, it's still Maggie Gyllenhaal, but it's a different singer-songwriter. Erica Elgin?
Mm. Yeah, that's what Elgin? It says here. Could swear that this appeared in some other movie before, like, and that's where it's best known from, but
it's probably a Maggie Gyllenhaal movie.
Yeah, that would make sense. And then the other big showstopper of the film, I Love You All.
This would have been
the Soronprfbs.
Prodigal son waits to return to where the dogs play pool.
This would have been the Oscar contender song.
Yeah, this is the one that they performed on the Colbert Report, and I think they might have actually closed out a film festival.
Yeah, they closed out the New York Film Festival.
Yeah, I've seen that clip too, and they both look so good that it made me wonder why they didn't just like do more performances of that.
Then the band
like
broke
it's
up.
Just like did we just accidentally make a really good band? What happened in our attempts to make an interesting quirky quirky indie black comedy? We accidentally created a really interesting band. How did that happen?
No idea. So yeah. And then they turn Lone Standing Tops into its own song.
Yep. And at the very bottom, there's For Release, but that's a Beethoven song.
So that was Frank.
Yep.
So anything else before we close this up with our rating system?
Nope.
All right. We got a rating system on this podcast. If it's good movie musical, it's hell of a musical. If it's a bad movie musical, it's hell is a musical. And if it's meh, it's Purgatory Pete's Razzmatazz Factory.
Yep.
Well, since it's your birthday.
Hell of a musical.
What? Hell is a musical?
Hell of a musical.
Oh, Lilz.
Of a musical. How dare you?
This is hell of a musical. Like, the songs are good. I mean, it's kind of like how The Commitments is a musical.
This is no joke, my favorite movie of all time.
Yeah.
Of course I'm going to give it a hell of a musical.
It's fun, it's weird, it's quirky, it's right up my alley. So what are we doing next before we get to Christmas?
Next time, let me try that again. Next time on Hell is a Musical, we're doing Tick, Tick, Boom.
Yeah, the reason why we're doing Tick, Tick, Boom so soon is it's getting all this award buzz, and let's find out if it's really, you know, buzzworthy.
Not the rock opera about the late 90s new metal band Saliva. That's Click Click Boom.
Boo.
I really hope that doesn't exist.
And just remember, if you find yourself in a band, you might be in a cult.
Ginger crouton. Floating in the soup.
With Lilz and Scott.
Neuroscience.